So greetings everyone, good evening and welcome to the 44th session of the online Optom learning series. Without ado, let me introduce to you our speaker for today. Today we have Mrs. Lakshmi Shinde. She has graduated from the Elite School of Optometry, Chennai, India in 1991, and she also holds a Master's in Optometry degree through research from the University of New South Wales, Sydney, Australia. Following graduation, she was also associated with the contact lens department of the L.V. Prasad Eye Institute, Hyderabad, India, where she was a contact lens consultant and was also associated with the contact lens clinical research studies carried out at LVPI. During her time with LVPI, she was also associated with IACL, where IACL was launched in the year 1993-94 in India. Following her completion of master's, she has been associated with IACL since then as an executive manager, and presently she is the global education executive manager of IACL. She is also the receiver of the prestigious American Academy Award for her contribution to international optometry. She's also received the Best Optometrist of the Year award from the Shankar Netralaya in 2016. She holds fellowships of the American Academy, Fellow of the IACL, and Fellow of the British Contact Lens Association, BCLA. She's also the CEO of the Optometry Council of India, which is the self-regulatory body for optometry in India. And she has a vast experience in teaching, presenting papers at national and international conferences and meetings, and has also published peer-reviewed journals. She also has a personal interest in contact lens teaching, especially being specialty contact lenses, and she shares her practice with her husband also. And welcome Lakshmi ma'am to our online platform. Today, she's going to talk to us about the contact lens fitting in terms of soft lens toric. How is it different from teaching versus how we do it practically? So thank you, ma'am, for taking out the time, and I'll hand over the screen to you.
Yeah, thank you. Thanks, Fakhruddin. Good evening, everybody. Evening for people in India, maybe late night for people in Malaysia and the other parts of Asia as well. So thanks, Fakhruddin, first of all, for this lovely opportunity. You know, it gave me some inspiration to, you know, get dressed, use the Indian sari, which we are unable to use in these times of lockdown. So a lot of inspiration for me to come out here and talk. So thanks for this lovely opportunity. As the topic goes, soft lens toric, teaching versus practice. So basically, I just wanted to go over what educators normally cover in the undergraduate level, and what's the importance of certain topics under soft contact lens topic, toric that they teach when it comes to practice, and sometimes how different is the practice compared to small things that you learn, not vastly, but small things that you learn as a student, and when you practice, what are the slight differences or adjustments that we have to make as a young practitioner when you move from a student to being a practitioner. So that's what is going to be covered. I'd like to thank all the industry sponsors of IACL here, because I've definitely used a lot of IACL slides in this presentation, and also thank IACL for you know, allowing me to use these as well. So as a student, what are the basic things, you know, you have to know before you go on to learn soft contact lens toric? So if you're an educator, some of you might be actually in some form of education, the things that you have to ask the students to recall, you know, before you actually go on to teaching soft contact lens toric are all this information. So what's astigmatism? What exactly causes astigmatism? What are the meridians in astigmatism? In the sense, what is the power meridian? What is an axis meridian, and so on? Even like, you know, as practitioners, sometimes we get confused. So all these things have to be in your fingertips as a student before you move on to actually learn soft contact lens torics. what basically causes astigmatism, which means like, you know, one meridian has to be steeper than the other and things like that, and classification of the basic refractive error types. So what happens when one meridian is steeper? So that does that lead to, you know, simple myopic or simple hyperopic astigmatism, or is the structure-wise, is the astigmatism lenticular or corneal and things like that. All this plays an important part in your lens selection when you actually, as a practitioner, are selecting a lens to go ahead and fit soft contact lens topics, as well as the types in terms of whether it's a regular astigmatism, irregular astigmatism, or whether axis-wise it's an oblique with the rule, against the rule, and so on. And so also with the magnitude of astigmatism and the incidence. So the higher the magnitude, lesser the incidence of those kind of astigmatism that we see. And also in terms of axis, what's the most common? Is with the rule most common? Is against the rule most common? Is oblique astigmatism so common, and so on. So all this information is something that the student needs to know before they actually get into learning soft contact lens torics. So as if you're an educator, the best thing is to maybe have some kind of a, you know, assignment or a test in all these aspects before you go on to teach your students about soft contact lens torics. And as practitioners also, many a time, because we really are not in touch with whatever we studied with time and practice, sometimes even, you know, if somebody asks us what's the axis of this, you know, what's the power meridian of this cylinder or something like that, we take a couple of minutes to kind of, you know, think and then give the answer for that. So these are things which we have to know, either be it a practitioner or a student, before we start off with soft contact lens torics. And this is just a schematic diagram. All of you would be familiar with it. So as I said, one needs to know exactly what's the power meridian, what's the axis meridian, and so on. Here it's an example of the horizontal meridian being more steeper than the vertical meridian, which is basically against the rule kind of a thing. So here, what we are talking about here is the magnitude. What's the importance of this? When you look at the slide, what you see here is the astigmatism that's less than 0.5 actually forms a major chunk of it. So until one diopter, you have 3/4 of the astigmatism covered in that. This study was in 1996, but however, the present data is a little bit different than this, because as we all know, myopia is increasing, especially in the Asian population. And given the structure of Asian eyes, myopia will also be along with some amount of astigmatism, associated with some amount of astigmatism as well. So definitely with the later papers and stuff, this prevalence is bound to increase and change compared to what is reported in 1996. And this is very important, because I allude to this sometime later in my talk as well, with respect to, you know, less than 0.5 and less than 1. Coming to the incidence of with the rule, against the rule, and oblique astigmatism, we find that in the younger population, with the rule is more common than compared to against the rule. And as the population ages, it becomes the other way around. Now, as a practitioner, this is very important to kind of have this in mind, basically because it gives rise to what kind of lenses you select in terms of prescribing for with the rule, what's your option that you have, and what kind of stabilization techniques will you opt for, as well as when you're looking at presbyopic correction for a person who has astigmatism. These are the things that you have to have in mind as a practitioner. So all these information which is presented to you as a student is very important in practice as well, basically because all this influences the lens selection and the stabilization technique that one would be looking at. Of course, in modern days, you have the topography, which helps you in giving you the entire corneal map and the amount of astigmatism as well. So this diagram, all of us are quite familiar with as practitioners. You know, it basically tells you compound myopic astigmatism and how a contact lens basically corrects it. But what is the reason for me to put this in place is that as an educator, you have to tell the students how these contact lenses, soft toric lenses, correct the different meridians that are present. So all of us know in astigmatism that there are two principal meridians, but how does the toric correct? So what I was thinking is a basic way of doing such a thing is that for an emetrope, you put them with some kind of a toric lens, and then you show them the blurness that the toric lens causes, and neutralize that with the refraction with the a tri lenses, and that tells you exactly how clear the vision would be. So that basically tells them the difference between correction and without correction, the vision a patient would be having, basically a myopic patient. So once they see or experience it themselves, then they really know the advantages of having a toric lens correction in the eye compared to maybe just a spherical lens that's put in the eye. So once you experience that, then you really remember it. Even for people who do not have a refractive error, the simple thing is to put a toric lens and then put the correction which is opposite to that on the trial plane to show them the visual difference. So what are the considerations that we have? I mean, what are the things that you consider when you are fitting a soft toric lens? One is the design of the lens. What's the stabilization technique that's used? Where are the reference marks? Because these vary from one brand to the other. Cornea thickness variation from superior to the inferior portion, whether that's differing or not, because that changes according to the manufacturing design, and the water content of the lens. So all these are to be considered by a practitioner as to what's the lens that you would basically recommend to the patient. Quite often, when we look at students' point of view, they ask, they're quite confused when we say that the lens needs to be stable on the eye with respect to soft toric lenses, because just then they would have finished soft spherical soft lenses, and we always say, yes, the lens needs to move because there needs to be tear exchange and so on. And here you're telling the lens needs to be stable for the axis to remain constant and stuff like that. So what we have to explain there is that it is the vertical movement that's very important in terms of tear exchange. Whereas what we don't want is the horizontal movement or the rotation of the lens. That's something that we really don't want. So this has to be properly explained to the student when somebody is teaching soft toric lenses, so that they really know, yes, there needs to be movement, but at the same time, we don't want rotation of the lens. So this is just a small video to explain the lens movement as the patient blinks. You can see the axis that's actually highlighted. The scribe marks are highlighted, if you can see that, with a slight green tinge. And then you can see that as the person blinks, yes, there is lens movement, but there is no misalignment of the axis of the lens. Okay, coming to stabilization methods, they're variable methods of stabilization. And what's the importance of that in today's talk? Well, I think the principal thing is you have to know what's the principle behind all of these various stabilization techniques that we're talking about. The principle is that the watermelon seed principle, that is, if you hold a watermelon seed in between two fingers and you try pressing it, the actual the thicker portion of the seed goes out first than compared to the thinner portion. So the same principle is actually used in terms of the eyelid. So the upper eyelid and the eye act as the two fingers, and basically when the soft contact lens is toric lens is placed, the thicker portion of the lens goes out first, which means the thicker portion always lands on the lower lid area of the eye. So that's the principle that in which all these stabilization methods are used for. Just a little bit of history in terms of soft toric lenses. Prism ballast lenses were the first kind of stabilization techniques that were used. The reason why we've moved away a little bit from this is because the lenses are a little more thicker, and because of the materials that were available in those days and because of the thickness as well, these led to a little bit of complication in terms of vascularization, especially between around 4 to 8 o'clock position. So over a period of time, these designs have been modified. So I'm going to talk about majorly just four designs. The reason being, as an educator, when you're teaching your students about all of this, you need to also tell them what's the brand of lens which uses this kind of stabilization technique and what's available in the market. So the students It's not just enough if you tell about all the stabilization techniques when they are not aware of what is available in the market and what's the stabilization of those kind of lenses that are available in the market, what is being used. So here in terms of advanced prism ballast design, what they do is they kind of thin out the periphery of the lens, but the prism is there in the inferior portion of the lens. There is a comfort chamfer around, and the optic zone, both in the front and the back portion of the lens, is adjusted in such a way that the thickness difference which occurs from the superior to inferior does not interfere with the power of the lens. So, but when you look at stabilizing methods, this kind of lens is pretty much stable when compared to other designs. The periballast is again a kind of lens using the same prism ballast technique, but here the weight of the lens is kind of more towards 4 and 8 o'clock, where the thicker portions are, and this is how they tend to stabilize the lens. So, and this is used in the Alcon type of lenses that are available in the market. The double slab off is where they do not involve the inferior, superior inferior portion of the soft contact lens, but the weight of the lens is more on the horizontal meridian. And I'll tell you what's the importance of knowing all of this when it comes to from the practitioner point of view. And of course, the advanced design of the same category is used by Johnson & Johnson. So when you look at all of these, so here in both periballast and prism ballast, you have a prismatic component, a very slight, very, very minimal prismatic component in the optic zone, which normally creeps in both these designs, okay? But when you look at the double slab off and the advanced design, both of them don't have any kind of prismatic component in their optic zone. So when you're looking at you know, people with some kind of minimal binocular vision anomalies or so on, it would maybe these two lenses maybe your first lens of preference compared to the others. But the lens preference again depends on also the refractive error and also what, whether it's with the rule or against the rule and stuff like that. Because with the rule, in terms of prism ballast, the average thickness is much lesser. So you might find the lenses to be stable again. So these are the different considerations that you would do as a practitioner. So all this information which you were taught, all this comes into play when you actually do a lens selection in terms of when you're advising a lens to a patient. The other thing, very important thing to keep in mind is the scribe marks. So these are just for orientation. They do not interfere with the vision. That is something that you have to tell the students. And also when these marks are basically to see exactly where the lens is resting, whether there is rotation or not. That's all is the purpose of this scribe mark. So again, these are the different types of scribe marks that you see, 6 and 12 o'clock position that you can have. Okay, and this is from Cooper Vision, which has only one scribe mark at 6 o'clock. We don't have these dotted lines, at least in India, available. You have 3, 6 and 9 o'clock, which is available from Alcon. And then you have the other three stripe marks which are available from Bausch & Lomb lenses with 30 degree you know, demarcation between each stripe mark. There are some lenses with 15, I'm not sure, but at least in India we don't have them as of now. The oxygen you know, component with respect to soft toric lenses is quite important, because especially when you look at prism ballast or periballast lenses, there is a thickness difference between the superior and the inferior portion, and in the other kind of design there is the thickness difference in the horizontal portion. So these things are very important to keep in mind, especially when you're fitting compromised cornea. So you can see an example of you know, how the oxygen permeability transmissibility is reducing from superior to the inferior portion. Especially these things you have to keep in mind as a practitioner. Let's say a post-LASIK patient comes to you with a slight refractive error, whether there is the residual cylinder, you are fitting them with soft toric lenses. You have to keep all this in mind and maybe call them for more frequent follow-up, because it's already a compromised cornea and these lenses can kind of you know, cause some kind of changes with regards to the hypoxic state of the cornea, or maybe one more would be a early keratoconus where you're fitting them with soft toric lenses. So as I said, the design definitely plays a role. So, you know, as practitioners, we really don't tend to give any importance to the stabilization technique which is used by the manufacturer. We just say, when the representatives comes, we just ask them, okay, what's the power range available, what's the access range available, and that's about it. So we really don't go into the details of, you know, what's the stabilization technique that's used, how is it different from some other manufacturers, what's the advantage and things like that. It's very important we get into all those details so that you really understand, among the range that is available to you in practice, what's the best one that would suit that particular patient who walks into your clinic. So as I said, for with the rule astigmatism, the average thickness with a prism ballast lens is lesser when compared to against the rule. When it comes to fitting of toric lenses, assessment of fit is more or less the same as in any soft contact lens. Of course, we do not want any rotation of the lens. So a good fit would be quick reorientation of the axis. In a tight fit, the reorientation will be very slow. And in a loose fit, it kind of keeps changing and it's very unstable. So this is something quite common in terms of knowing this. Okay, coming to fitting methods, there is a lot of argument of, you know, a trial lens fitting versus empirical fitting. Now let's take a practice, and especially nowadays, when a person walks in, you know, saying, or walks in with a prescription and you're recommending a toric, or says, okay, I need to get rid of my glasses, what's the best way to do so, and he has a cylindrical prescription, you advise toric lenses. They want things fast. They want less chair time. They want to be, you know, taking away the prescription the same day if possible, or at the most the next day. So when you look at practice-wise, trial lenses really do not work these days. So it's better we just do empirical fitting. And, you know, people might say, what if you have rotation? You know, so what if you have rotation? You can always tell the industry, manufacturer that, okay, I fitted this lens, it's not working well, the lens is rotating on the eye, so can you change the box to another, you know, power with the correction? And even for the manufacturer, you know, it works out much, much more economical for them to exchange these boxes, because the amount of rotation that happens in a large population is very, very minimal. If you fit 100 patients with soft toric lenses, at the most, maybe two or three of them would come to you with lens rotation. So it's not a big deal, and it works out much more economically for them to replace these packs rather than providing with trial lenses for everybody. And there is less chair time, less number of visits for the patient to come to you. And, you know, the patient is also happy because he came to you with an issue, you solved it, he's going home with the lenses in his eyes. So that's the main issue when you're looking at competition and when you're, you know, against other practices. The best is to follow empirical fitting. Coming to the corneal coverage, you have to look at complete corneal coverage. And of course, you know, as I said, in a good fit, there is quick return of the mislocated axis and so on. Coming to the scribe marks, it's very important that when, as an educator, when you teach, you tell them that in case there is rotation, when you're doing the compensation for the axis rotation and asking for a different lens, when the new lens comes, the scribe mark will not be at 6 o'clock, or will not be at, you know, 3 and 9 o'clock, or will not be at 6 and 12 o'clock. It's very important to tell the students that the reason for your compensation is because the lens is rotating. So even the final lens will rotate to the same position, but then because you've made the axis compensation, the patient will have good vision. So that is something which is very, very commonly mistaken by students, and that's something which the educator has to emphasize on. Before we go on to the last rule and all of that, there's something that we really need to know is, normally in any soft toric lenses, when fitted on the eye, it does have a rotation of 5 degrees or so. And it's anti-clockwise in the right eye and clockwise in the left eye. Why is that? That is because of the lid action, the lid forces that are there whenever you blink. So, and that also affects or depends on the prescription, the axis, the thickness variation that you have per person, and so on. So how does that affect? So when you look at this image, you can see that the lid action is in this direction, right? The direction of the green arrows. So what happens in that movement is the lens tends to move towards the nose in both the eyes. The right eye, it will be anti-clockwise because it moves towards the nose. In the left eye, it will be clockwise because it moves towards the nose. Okay. What's the importance of this? I'll explain. So why do we need to really know all of this, you know, in practice? Why, what's the uniqueness of this? So let's say you get an oblique axis, okay, of a prescription of, let's say, 25 degrees or 135 degrees, a very odd axis because the manufacturers give it to you only in 10 degree steps, right? So here you have a prescription of 25 degrees or 135 degrees. What you would do, let's say 25 is present on the right eye, okay? And we said that the lens kind of moves towards the nose, which is onto your right side, right? So right movement means subtract, right? So you would rather order a 20 degree lens in the right eye for this patient rather than going in for a 30 degree lens. And similarly, if let's say 135 is in the left eye, we would rather go in for a 40 degree because left you have to add. So here you would go in for a 140 rather than a 130. So these things are very important in practice to remember, because when you're prescribing for these patients, you want to give the best because that's what you want to do in your practice. And these small things are very important to consider when you're in practice. So the other things is, of course, measure the prescription and vertex distance, select the soft contact lens design, toric design that you want. You make the vertex distance compensation in case the powers are very high, and then your the basic of selection and total diameter depending on the brand that you're looking at, and of course the axis orientation. And all of us are quite familiar with the last rule, which is clockwise add and anti-clockwise subtract. The difficult cases, as suggested here, is you know, with the rule astigmatism where the spherical power is very less, or oblique astigmatisms, cylinders and high cylinders. So when we teach, we do tell that these are difficult cases to fit. But it doesn't mean that you cannot fit these cases when you're in practice. Okay. The reason being, let's say this particular patient of plus 0.25 with minus 0.25 cylinder with the rule astigmatism. Let's say he's a young boy who's into a lot of sports. Okay. And if you're able to give a minus 2.5 cylindrical plano cylinder, and the vision that he gets out of that and the blur that the plus 0.25 is going to cause is very minimal, and actually, you know, makes him get rid of his glasses and gives him much more comfort when he's actually playing sport, then this is an excellent candidate for soft toric lenses. So although while teaching we do say that these are, you know, challenging cases, it doesn't mean that in practice you really don't go ahead and try these lenses or advise toric lenses for such patients. Again, the same thing for oblique cylinders as well. The amount of distortion both these kind of high cylinders and the oblique cylinders cause in terms of spectacles and in terms of contact lenses, where you're getting rid of all those kind of distortions and giving a better quality vision, if there is even a slight amount of you know, blurred vision caused because of some kind of, you know, either power is not the exact, or there is a little the 5 degree compensation for the axis is not available, that is much less compared to what he would actually experience, the distortion that he would experience with spectacles. So all depends on the patient motivation and the patient's occupation, and you advise according to that rather than, you know, going by textbook exactly what's been taught. Because, you know, in these kind of cases, especially young practitioners would say, oh, this is a difficult one. I don't think, you know, soft audits will suit you, or your pass too high. I don't think we can go ahead and fit a lens in your case and things like that. Especially like these kind of powers, you can always get a custom design made lenses. And these are areas where you tend to excel as an optometrist when compared to maybe your competitor, when you actually take the risks of going ahead and fitting these. You can always say that I'll try. If it doesn't fit, then that's fine. You know, you can go ahead with glasses. This is just a summary of all the things that we normally do in a soft toric lens fitting. You have to take history, measure the visual acuity. The most important thing that I wanted to highlight was you have to, especially in cases where it's less than 0.75 cylinder, you give both options. You can give the option of spherical contact lenses and a spherocylindrical correction. Make the patient see the difference in visual acuity between the two, and then let him decide which lens is better in terms of giving him better vision. So that time, what happens is the cost never becomes an issue because he's already seen the difference between the toric and the spherical correction. You can always put the spherical equivalent in the trial frame, show him that, and then put the correct correction and then show him saying this is the difference in visual acuity that you will be having. And there are people who actually are very sensitive to that kind of 0.5 cylinder as well, so where they do not accept just a spherical correction alone. So that is something which I just wanted to highlight here. The other thing is, of course, in terms of, teaching, as a teaching institute, you would always, look at a rotation and say, okay, if the lens rotates, you can always, relocate it and show them the increase in vision and so on. But, as I said, how many of these lenses rotate? And, why would industry actually, for practitioners, say there is a first fit guarantee and stuff like that? Or they will take back the lens back in case there is rotation and replace it with the new prescription. So why would they do it if there is so much of rotation in the population that's occurring? Actually, in practice, there's hardly, but especially the improved kind of stabilization techniques that are present today, there's hardly any percentage of population that you actually do see a lot of lens rotation. So that is the main reason I say we can definitely confidently go ahead and fit umbilical fitting. And don't, there is always this, a mind block among young practitioners saying, oh, toric is something, I need to know Lasol, I need to calculate, I need to do this and all of that. It's quite simple. It's not rocket science. All you need to know is just the last rule, and it really occurs maybe, one in 70 patients in fit, or, maybe high myopic oblique astigmatism, you can occur. And how often do you see high myopic oblique astigmatism? Even the incidence of that in the population is less. So I would really recommend that all of us kind of, be proactive in advising these people to go in for toric lenses. And there is evidence as well. So this paper, if you read the conclusion, efficacy of toric contact lenses and fitting, it says toric contact lenses are a good option when trying to improve the vision in patients with moderate astigmatism, given the subjective improvement. That means even in low astigmats, they do appreciate the cylindrical correction when it is given. And there is the difference in vision when compared to spherical equivalent and the toric prescription that you give. And when you look at teaching, so I just came across this website which said that, so what's the indication? They say that it has to be greater than 0.75. So what about 0.75 and less? You basically don't correct them. Of course, you can go ahead and correct them because that would definitely give a better vision for the patient than compared to the spherical equivalent. So what's being taught and what's in practice varies slightly, and this is one of the important reasons for that. On the other hand, so when you look at this, they say greater than 0.75. So are we doing a good job there? Well, there also we don't do a very good job when you are prescribing toric correction, because in this international survey, the conclusion is, at the present time, in the majority of countries surveyed, toric soft contact lens prescribing falls short of that's what's required. So neither are we fitting well in less than 0.75. And if we say that more than 0.75 is indicated, neither are we doing a good job as practitioners there by prescribing soft toric lenses as an option for vision correction. So I think it's up to us as practitioners to really, you know, push the bar up and increase it, and for our own good, because this is going to increase business, this is going to increase revenue as well. I'm just going to go through a few examples with regards to all these cases. So the first one is a 19-year-old boy using spectacles for about 8 years and wished to wear contact lenses, okay? And the spectacle refraction is 5.75 with a 0.75 cylinder at 90, which means it is against the rule astigmatism. Often the soft contact lens given, quite often, when you look at, you know, what its distance compensation and so on, will be a 5.5 diopter sphere, because you think that only more than 0.75 needs to be prescribed. But the ideal one would be a 5.25 with a 0.75. And the vision, if you prescribe a soft spherical equivalent, would be something like that. Whereas when you prescribe a toric ones, is much more crisper and sharper. Yeah. So when you have an option of actually prescribing something better for the patient, I think one should, as a practitioner, give that option to the patient. And in case they don't want and they want to go in for a spherical equivalent, well, that's there. But then as a practitioner, I think it's our duty to actually tell them what's best for them. The second case is a 21-year-old young lady who wishes to wear soft contact lenses. And as a profession, she's a receptionist and she works around 10 hours a day and so on. And that's the refractive error of the patient. So what's the soft contact lens prescription, okay, that you would prescribe, and the lens is available is in 10 degree steps. So if you remember what I had told you with regards, you know, the physiological rotation, that would be your prescription. Okay, so in one eye, you would reduce the axis that is in the right eye, and in the other eye, you would increase. And why wouldn't you prescribe 30 and 150 degrees? That's because, as I said, in the right eye, the rotation is towards the nose, and so also in the left eye, it's again towards the nose. So that's why you would increase in the right eye, and in the other eye, you would do it the other way around. So the third case is a spectacle refraction of -6 and -3. Okay. The soft contact lens prescription, is this the right one, is the question. Because if you draw a cross cylinder, in one axis it will be 6, in the other axis it will be 9, correct? So for 6, the vertex distance correction is 5.5. For a 9, if you take, is it 2.75, which makes it like 8.25? Yeah. So if you do that, then what does the toric prescription become? It becomes 2.25. So basically, in these kind of cases, it's best to draw the cross cylinder and then actually do the vertex distance compensation, because this is one of the common mistakes that people make when they tend to look at prescriptions and ask and look at soft contact lens trials. So what's the take-home message with all of this? I thought this is the best, you know, article which gives a very good summary of toric contact lens fitting. So what does it say? Helping patients who have astigmatism can be a rewarding experience. Improvement in lens materials, stabilization designs, and parameter range have made fitting soft toric lenses more efficient and predictable. As I said, we need not really be worried about lens rotation, because the materials that are being used, the stabilization designs that are being used, are so good that we hardly see patients with lens rotation issues. and for challenging prescriptions and demanding personalities who rhetoric soft contacting success goes beyond just the last word. That's because you have to look into the person's occupation, what the person's demands are, and then as a clinician, give what's the best option that's available among the lenses. And that actually is much more rewarding to you as a clinician and also rewarding to the patient in terms of visual rehabilitation. So I thought that was a very good message, you know, in terms of practicing optometrists to really know that these are areas where we really need to push ourselves and make ourselves much, much more efficient in the area that we actually practice as, you know, providers of good vision care. So that brings me to the end of the topic.
Okay, thank you. Thank you so much, ma'am. I think this was a very comprehensive talk and a very brief indeed. I'm just going to take the first question which we have received, ma'am. The first question is, any particular stabilization design which we need to consider if we have patients with against the rule or with the rule astigmatism? Is there any particular consideration?
Yeah, see, against the rule is not a problem at all. Against the rule, lenses rotate the least in any design. Okay, so against the rule, astigmatism are the best candidates when it comes to soft contact lens, I mean soft toric contact lens fitting, because there is hardly any rotation that you see with against the rule astigmatism. Now, for with the rule astigmatism, because they are more prone to rotation, maybe depending on you know, the power of the lens. If it is minimal cylinder, then I would say any of the lenses are good. But when you're looking at higher cylinders, maybe a prism ballast or a advanced prism ballast or a periballast design would be a better one in terms of fitting with the rule astigmatism. But as I said, you know, the things have moved so much in terms of technology and stabilization that you might find even the other lenses doing equally well when compared to a periballast or a prism ballast with the rule astigmatism. But what I'm saying is, when you're looking at, you know, let's say a problem case, you fitted a lens, but it tends to, you know, rotate slightly or something like that. You can always try another brand with a different stabilization technique, which may stabilize better than the one that's actually showing you rotation.
Okay. The next question which we have got here is, can we find what the toric lens is by just looking at the lens?
Yes, because with the scribe marks, you know, because the scribe marks are going to be different. Yeah, so you will know which brand it is by just looking at the scribe marks.
Yeah, I think you did mention in your talk earlier on the different type of scribe marks.
Yeah, correct. So these are the things. So as an educator, you know, we always say, okay, you might find this scribe mark, but we don't corroborate the scribe mark with the brand. And that's very important when you teach students that you have to do that, because then only they are prepared for practice tomorrow, right? Then they are also ready for internship. So when they go into internship and when they start seeing lenses, it kind of hits them that, okay, you know, mark at 6 o'clock means it is a Johnson & Johnson lens. A mark at 3 and 9 o'clock and 6 o'clock means that it is an Alcon lens and things like that. So you have to corroborate the scribe mark with the brand so that they are practice ready when they actually go.
And the other question is, will the orientation of the lens be influenced by the lid, whether it's a tight lid or a loose lid? And if that's the case, what type of a particular design should be considered?
Okay, so yes, it is definitely influenced by a tight or a loose lid. Okay. The designs, the stabilization technique that uses very less lid interaction is the double slab off and the advanced double slab off design. Okay, so those where you find that the thickness is more in the horizontal region, those are the designs which have the least influence or least influenced by the lid interaction with the cornea. that so if you find that the you know the lid is not really helping you in stabilizing the lens, then these kind of stabilization technique design lens may be a better option for those kind of patients. But yes, definitely the lid plays a role in terms of orientation of the lens, and this will also not only the lids, it also depends on the prescription of the person, whether it's high myope, whether it's an oblique astigmat, and all of that also plays a part.
I think this is one of the connecting question. I was reading the chat earlier. Somebody asked on how would you go about selecting the stabilization method based on your preliminary examination. So maybe prescription and the lid laxity would basically give you a clue, right?
Yes.
Basically prescription.
And also, when you look at manufacturers, right, they have different cylindrical axis availability.
Okay.
So not all the manufacturers have all axes available in the different powers. So when you look at the wide spectrum, let's say even if you take the four major manufacturers, at least that are available in India, you will know what range and power range and axis range each one has, correct?
Yeah.
So when you look at those, that kind of narrows down your selection. And among that, if you have to select, yes, it will depend upon the lid tone, the stabilization technique that they are using, and also whether it's a hydrogel, it's a silicone hydrogel, what's the occupation of the patient in comparison to whether you could advise a hydrogel versus a silicone hydrogel and all of that. So all these put together is what you have to depend on when you are prescribing.
Okay. And another continuation question about stabilization. So which stabilization design works better or have to prescribe in case of higher cylinders?
Which that, one that will depend on the axis.
Axis, okay.
You know, it will depend on the axis of the cylinder. If it is with the rule astigmatism or against, as I said, against the rule, you generally don't have issues of stabilization. If it's going to be with the rule and if it is a high cylinder, let's say a perfect with the rule, not anywhere, let's say 160 or something like that, but actually 180, then maybe you can look at the advanced prism ballast or a periballast design.
Okay. So the other question would be, okay, this is a bit of in lines with the explanation what you gave to us about the selection of lens in terms of 25 degrees or 135, which manufacturers don't really have. So this is a question about 22 degrees for the right eye. So what should we order?
So if it's 20, then you'll order 22, you'll order 20.
So we go towards the closer side. Okay. We do have one more question. Should toric lenses be prescribed for the cylinder of 0.5 diopters?
Absolutely. I would say there are a lot of patients, at least that we've come across, where that 0.5 cylinder does make a difference. It does make a difference in terms of correction. So I would say that is where I think we as optometrists are falling short. Because, you know, when you look at textbooks and things like that, historically, we've been told it's only 0.75 and above that we need to correct. But there is more and more evidence that's coming in terms of publications that I also showed you that we are falling short by not correcting these kind of patients. And I seriously think that is an issue, even from the patient's point of view. Because if we have something that's available to give that correction, then why aren't we doing it?
The next question is about fitting. So how successful will it be to try spherical equivalent rather than toric lenses? And do you prefer to have kind of candidate selection which would suit best for spherical equivalence or which would suit best for torics?
I would say I really am not a person who advocates spherical equivalent.
Okay.
If you have places available in the toric correction, we have to go ahead with the toric. That will be your first lens of choice. No spherical equivalent. But there are always, you know, practitioners say, oh, you know, cost is an issue and all of that. But, you know, when you actually show the patient the difference between the spherical equivalent and the toric correction, if you put it on the trial frame, you actually show them the difference. If you feel that the patient is not able to appreciate the difference, they say both are almost the same, then maybe that candidate is better for a spherical equivalent. But most of the patients do appreciate the difference and they say, no, I think that's more sharper. I think I would prefer the, you know, toric lens prescription.
Okay. We just take
an option, as I said, you know, if, for example, let's say an occasional, where the cylindric correction is less and they want to wear it only for certain occasions, not a regular soft contact lens wearer. For those kind of patients, if they just want to wear it only for occasions and stuff like that, then maybe you can consider spherical equivalent because the sharpness of vision is not something that's going to really affect them because they keep swapping between spectacles and contact lenses. So these, as I said, as a practitioner, these are the different things that you might have to consider when prescribing.
Okay. You have a couple of more questions. So, What do you think would be a good age to start prescribing toric lenses? Is age a factor? Do you consider that as a factor for prescribing toric lenses?
No, not at all. Why would I? When we're looking, this is the age when we're looking at things like myopia control and stuff, where we are fitting patients with even like 7 years, 8 years of age with contact lenses. Especially like even myope up to 6 and so on. So why would you even think of age as a factor when you're prescribing soft toric lenses, which are just normal prescription lenses? I really don't think age is should be a barrier, at especially now at this age and time where we should be prescribing younger and younger children with contact lenses because they're definitely much better than spectacles in relation to myopia and myopic astigmatism. So I would say start as early as possible in terms of giving the correct correction in terms of soft lenses, if not myopic control.
Okay. And we'll take the last question if there are no other questions as of now. How much of astigmatism will be fully covered when prescribing spherical soft lenses?
It's not covered at all.
Okay. I knew that so answer would come.
In theory, you see, that's the reason. I think these are things, small points, which are very, very important when you look at teaching versus practice. Okay, so when you look at textbooks, old textbooks, they kind of say, the thickness of the lens will mask a little bit of astigmatism. It does not. The present lenses, it does not mask any astigmatism. So they're not corrected. If you do an over-refraction, over-spherical lens that you do, I mean, if you fit it on a toric cornea and if the astigmatism is corneal, you will get residual astigmatism. You can do a retinoscopy and try the lens. You will get residual astigmatism. It is not corrected. Yeah. It's not corrected.
Okay.
And there's so, you know, the lenses are so thin, so flexible nowadays that they don't. The reason why earlier they were talking about that, because most of the lenses were lathe cut, when we were studying and stuff. So in those days, because they were lathe cut manufactured, the lenses were thicker and less flexible, right? So because of the thickness and the flexibility factor, in those days, yes, they used to say, yes, it can mask 0.5 astigmatism and so on, not with the present day lenses.
Okay. So I think we have taken up almost, most of the questions. Some people were asking on, recap of the principle what you shared, the technique which you explained about the lip closure and how to go about the 5-degree adjustment.
Yeah, so basically what happens is because, see, from the lids, the way they act is from outside, they move in. You know, this is the lid action, right? So what happens in the right eye, the lens tends to move a little bit towards the nose, in the left eye also, it tends to move towards the nose. So from your point of view, as a practitioner, it's always, Lars rule is always from the practitioner point of view, right? So when you look at the right eye, it moves to your right, correct? And then the left eye moves, the left lens moves to your left. So that's how the normal movement happens, that you know, 3 to 4 degrees happens.
Okay. There's one interesting question, I don't know, let me just take it. Is about therapeutic lenses and fitting of soft toric lenses as for therapeutic purposes because of distortion and aberration. So what's your take on that? Would you fit a toric lens as a therapeutic lens to reduce the amount of aberration?
Why would you do that? My question would be, if there is aberration, the aberration is because of high minus power, what's the cause? That's what we need to look at. What's the cause of the aberration? Is it high prescription that's actually causing, you know, the first order aberrations that you, first and second order aberrations that you see normally? Or is it something else that's causing the aberration? If it's something internal in the eye that's causing the aberration, you really can't give a soft toric lens to reduce. Okay, but if it's high prescription, when you compare spectacles to contact lenses, definitely there is improvement, be it spherical or toric, you know, in terms of high prescriptions. If, as I said, if it is, let's say, I'll just give you two examples. Let's say if it is a -6 spherical with a 0.5 cylinder, he would have distortion, you know, compared from a spectacle compared to a contact lens. The contact lens would provide much sharper vision, be it spherical, be it toric, because his cylindrical correction is 0.5. But on the other hand, let's say if you have a -2 with a -4 cylinder, definitely a toric lens would give lesser aberration when compared to spectacles again. So what is the cause of the aberration is the question. So, but if it is something internal in the eye that's actually leading to aberration, maybe a minimal cataract or polar cataract or something else, you know, then you're not going to, your lens is really not going to help in that.
Yeah. So the cause of aberration must be known. That's the particular reason I took this question, because when you were saying that toric lenses are good and all that, so we should not be, you know, everybody is good candidate, but you should know the cause of why there is a need.
Yes, what's the cause of the aberration? Yeah. And is, you know, our contrast sensitivity going to be affected because of this and stuff like that? That's a different, you know, question, especially in people with certain kind of occupation where they need more contrast to be clear and stuff like that. So what's the exact reason for the aberration and what's the patient demand? So that has to be corroborated for you to prescribe something.
Now, thank you so much, Lakshmi ma'am, for taking out the time and answering to all the questions what the attendees had.
Thank you. I should thank you, Fakhruddin. Lovely to have spoken with such an, I think, you know, so many questions, such an interactive audience. I think I really enjoyed, and hopefully it's the other way around as well. Hopefully, you know, people kind of gain something from this talk.
I think definitely everybody has definitely gotten something or the other from this session. So thank you everyone for attending. Again, thank you Lakshmi ma'am from the whole entire team of Online Optom Learning Series for taking out your time and taking this wonderful interactive session.
Thank you. Thanks a lot.
To the attendees, you're most welcome, ma'am. To the attendees, we do have sessions next week, so please stay tuned. We will be sending out emails and updating our WhatsApp group for you to get the meeting links. So stay tuned. Until then, stay home, stay safe, and I'll see you all again next week. Take care and bye-bye.